Hello and welcome to today's webinar. My name is Christine Perret. I'm going to be speaking with you today about augmented reality right now. What is its status in 2014? I want to quickly thank the IEEE for hosting today's webinar. The presentation is the second in a series of virtual events that we're conducting about augmented reality. And the purpose of this session is to really dig into what's happening today and why. I'm going to be describing who makes augmented reality experiences, what their skills are, what kinds of
companies. To unmute your line, press star 6 or pound 6.
Places where you can go and discover augmented reality yourself in the world around you. I'll also be giving you a snapshot of the state of the art in four key areas. My presentation will conclude a few minutes before the top of the hour, and that way I'll be able to take your questions, and we'll have a short Q&A session. If you want to ask a question, please type that into the WebEx chat feature, and our host, David, will manage those as they come in. Now I'll go ahead and get started. And if everyone can please mute their lines, we won't have any interruptions. So first, let me introduce myself. I'm a researcher. I do market research, and I study spines. I study those in order to formulate technology and business landscapes in a very chaotic environment, new technology and emerging technologies in the mobile space. And on top of that, or on the basis of those landscapes and better understandings about what's developing in the world of mobile and multimedia, I prepare initiatives and strategies, and I provide consulting services to my clients so that we can all have much more measurable impacts in this world, and particularly how we can change the way people consume and deliver and publish information. So the topic that we're going to talk about today is augmented reality in 2014 in the current situation. I think it's important to have some perspective on the past, and people tend to focus very heavily on what's coming and what's in the future. Today, though, I really want to look at the present and what's popular. So I'll go ahead and get started. Last time, I introduced augmented reality as having a lot of emphasis or really being focused on the user. Augmented reality is a suite of technologies that helps an end user better understand their environment and what their tasks are. We do that by introducing a lot of context, and that context can be introduced through the sensors on a mobile device, such as the camera, the GPS, the compass, gyroscope, and others, as well as sound, and eventually we'll have touch and smell and taste be part of our context. And using these inputs and combining them over networks and through displays, perhaps on our person or in our hands or on the surfaces around us, combining those with the digital content, then we can deliver augmented reality experiences. What does that mean? Well, they change our perception of reality by combining the information from the digital world with the real world. They synchronize that information with reality. This is a graphic that I walked through last time as well. If you haven't been through it, it just helps us to see that using a mobile device today, primarily smartphones and tablets that are heavily embedded with lots of sensors, we can take readings and observations of the physical world around us. Those observations follow the little white lines up into the cloud and get analyzed on servers. And then other assets that could be text, image, graphics, or 3D models are sent back down to this device and displayed in a manner that makes them look like they're overlaid on the real world. So it might be the name of a mountain, a city, or some other geographic feature. Could also be something that you see in the physical world, like the tower in the lower right-hand corner, could trigger a game or some kind of a game feature. Or you could see a boat, detect a boat, and combine that with the timetable for the boat, and it will predict when it's going to arrive at your dock. I also like to remind people about how the augmented reality industry is segmented. We can do that in a variety of different ways, and here's just a few of them. First of all, we can think of augmented reality as being serving different end user target customers. And we can say some of them are consumers, people who are at play or, you know, just living their lives, going about their business, and they have a less rigid need for precision, and they can tolerate a little bit more latency, but they're not willing to tolerate high cost. So they're very cost-sensitive consumers. On the other hand, professional users tend to want a high performance, high precision, and depending on what the purpose is, they're willing to pay a little bit more. So there's a return on investment calculation that needs to be made for a professional user. Augmented reality can be brought to the user in a variety of different ways in a very highly instrumented environment with projectors and other kinds of sensors. We can do what's called projection AR. And again, this is an environment in which a lot of the factors are controlled and stationary and tends to be very expensive, but provide a very immersive experience. Might be used for training people to operate new objects or new vehicles, or in this case, to detect where and how to navigate when there are landmines in a field. There's also augmented reality that can be delivered on the desktop or in a kiosk environment based on a desktop computer. And those were some of the first that people were acquainted with, and they could, for example, put a digital mask over a person's face. So you can see that already today. Sometimes in Google Hangout, there's a little feature that tracks the face and adds drawings to the subject. The most popular and most common form of augmented reality is delivered to the mobile device, to a smartphone or a tablet. And those are going to be the subject of the next slide. So when you use a mobile device to determine what the user's context in, you have a context is, you have more information. If you use the GPS and the compass, you'll know what the person is looking at, the direction the person is looking, and the distance that they are from some points of interest. Then if you're using the camera to detect and to analyze the content of the scene around the user, then what's happening is that there are computer vision algorithms that extract patterns, and they're also called features, and they extract those from the video signal and then analyze those and bring an overlay experience based on what is triggered in the image. In both geospatial-based AR and computer vision-based AR, the use of gyroscope and accelerometer really helps to make the experience more precise. There's a lot of ways in which these two differ, even though they might look similar. The geospatial is best for outdoor, and it also provides experiences that people are more familiar with because it's kind of like navigation with a mobile device, but it's not always necessary for the AR experience to take you somewhere. It could be something you experience locally right around you. And one of the reasons they're popular is because they're usually provided at no cost in this category of applications called mobile AR browsers. Geospatial AR also lets your battery life go longer, so it has less impact on the battery. So a lot of people want to know how many people are out there using mobile augmented reality today. And that's really hard to estimate, but we can make some calculated guesses, and certainly many companies that do research and forecasts are studying where the direction that's going in. We know that today there's about 1.2 billion smartphones, and that those have the sensors and the graphics hardware necessary already to do augmented reality at a basic level. And we also know that in addition to those, there's a lot of tablets that have cameras and the same kind of hardware, or even faster, better performing hardware. Of those, of all of those smartphones and tablets, there's currently somewhere under 100 million activated users. There have been estimates that there are as many as 60 million users last year. And probably what it is that there's some double counting here. There are people who are registered or who are active more than once using multiple different mobile augmented reality software applications. So the question is, should you count on the basis of the number of applications that have been issued, the number of devices that are enabled? What do you do with a person who's got two or more devices that are all ready for augmented reality to deliver that? Those are difficult questions for market researchers and make it challenging for us to be able to answer the question of how many are out there. So let's just assume there are somewhere under 100 million people out there in the world. Around all parts of the globe, augmented reality can be used. And now, what are they using it for? The primary uses today are the communications between a brand, some type of a company that wants to communicate with a consumer or customer. And the fast-moving consumer goods companies have really embraced augmented reality in a big way. So we'll see a lot of examples of food products, beverages, other consumables, you know, soaps and things like that. And entertainment companies also like to add augmented reality to engage people with a poster, perhaps, for a movie. The automotive industry has been using augmented reality for a very long time, relatively speaking, and in the recent few years has been showing augmented reality to market and sell new vehicles, to configure a vehicle, for example, that you might want to order. Or you might also use augmented reality in the automobile once you've purchased it to better learn the features of the dashboard and other surfaces. Real estate is another area, another subject where people have really embraced augmented reality, especially geospatial augmented reality, to show where property is for sale or for rent, or to interact with a brochure to show what the model home might look like, or what from a 2D printed page to have the physical built environment pop out of the page. And that helps people understand and see where they would work or live. Fashion is another domain that has used augmented reality to show you how your glasses might appear. Eyewear, for example, you know, your sunglasses or correction lenses, how jewelry might appear, or clothing. Learning is another domain in which there are many, many, many examples, and I'll get into that in a more deeper way in a minute. The reason that we see so much use of AR for engagement with consumers is because the user experience is so important to the brands. They want to provide excitement. They want to provide information as well as to establish a sense of authority and trust. So they want to know about what people need, and augmented reality can often help the brand find out where the user is when they're inquiring about a product, help the user to make decisions on their purchase, and perhaps then be more loyal customers or purchase a product again and again. This is quite common. So I mentioned before that beverage companies have really embraced augmented reality. This is an example of an augmented reality application that is launched by scanning a bottle of Pepsi. And there are dozens of these, maybe more. They don't last a very long time. They try to target a particular event, specifically in this example, a sports event. There are lots of sports teams that have also embraced augmented reality to speak and to communicate with their fans. This is another way for people to, you know, communicate and have this affinity for a particular person or place or thing. So you'll be watching for those products in your environment. I'm sure you'll see some calls to action. In the home, there are a couple of other examples I can point to. I know that there's a lot of magazines and newspapers that have begun to use augmented reality. And another company that is in the home is IKEA, and they ship, I don't know how many, forgotten how many tens of millions of catalogs they mail to people's homes every year. And for the last few years, these have been assisted or can be further enabled with an augmented reality application. In this year's catalog, there's over 100 pieces of furniture that are modeled in 3D, and you can configure their color or texture. You can have add or remove different features and in a modular manner, and then you can also kind of move the furniture out of the page of the catalog into your physical room. And this helps people to, again, make decisions on their purchase choice. And it's also fun and engaging. So in general, businesses, large enterprises as well as medium size and small, like to use augmented reality because it's kind of halfway between the web, which is all digital and requires you to be somewhere where you have internet access and you're separate, you're not thinking about the real world, and it bridges that with the print or the real world. And it helps, because all the interactions are tracked, it helps the brand know what the customer likes best, and it's relatively easy. It's as about the same order of magnitude as providing information on the web or another digital format, so it's relatively easy to author and publish these experiences, and it's very easy for consumers who get a hold of them and like them to share them with their friends and for these to go viral. So it's very, the action, you know, kinesthetic learning and engagement is memorable and helps us to form these bonds with products and companies. And it simplifies configuration or selection of a product, as I've already mentioned in the IKEA example. And there are many, many other examples as well. Another important driver for augmented reality for these companies to use for communications is it's part of an overall communications campaign. Augmented reality doesn't just stand by itself. It's part of a communication campaign with print, web, radio, television, posters, and other types, other forms of communication. That's one reason. They know how to do that, how to integrate the same messages. At the same time, the developers or the creative professionals that are making the augmented reality experiences know how to sell the campaigns, and so they have a clear value proposition. They have some idea of what the willingness to pay is, and so there's a business model for both the brands and the developers. So I did a survey recently of the companies that provide the AR authoring environments, and I asked them if across the wide variety of publishers they have, what the trends are. And they've told me that the trends tend to be towards a lengthening or a direction of longer campaigns so that the materials that you bought or that were sent to you 1 month ago or 3 months ago or something will still be active if you look at them today. And the AR campaigns, on average, are running between 1 and 4 weeks in duration before, you know, the packaging changes or the there's a new issue of a particular journal or a catalog that's published. So another area that I think is getting to be almost mainstream is using augmented reality in learning. That might be formal learning, like school learning, like I've got here an example of a high school, and there are dozens of these, maybe hundreds around the world, where companies where there's some instructional material to help students or the faculty or the teachers learn how to develop augmented reality experiences as part of their learning process. So remember how sometimes we've gone back in school long, long time ago, we taught keyboard skills, and then we saw a few decades where people were learning how to use desktop productivity tools at school. Well, now people are starting to use augmented reality as part of their communications tools, just like they know how to edit short videos and publish them on YouTube. They also learn how to do this. But there are people who are also thinking much, much, much earlier in the development cycle of people and their learning and providing augmented reality applications for the very young. So in this case, PBS has some applications, and some of them are augmented reality assisted to help a young learner know the names of shapes. There are technical colleges and trade schools and other places where augmented reality can be used to test the learner's awareness or learning progress. I think, you know, looking at this at a high level, one of the reasons that augmented reality is doing well in learning is because learning is a lot about discovery and associating information with our world around us, but also because the technology is there. Establishments and schools have been providing tablets to the classroom, and educators then have these tools. They're also shaping the students that are in the future going to become end users and developers of augmented reality. So ERASMA, which is a division of Hewlett-Packard, and LAYER have specifically conducted many campaigns to get into the school training programs and advance this hand-in-hand with the tablets. The learner engages with the real world, so we overcome some of the problems and the tendency to forget about the real world or to be stationary and not have exercise and so forth. Augmented reality also helps because it's outcome-based learning, and usually if you're just looking at a drawing or a two-dimensional image, poster, or something in a textbook, a high precision isn't necessary. And it's lower cost than distributing textbooks, much more engaging and more applicable to things that people do in their daily lives. So speaking of doing something in our daily lives, what about people who want to become AR experienced developers? Who are those people and what do they need to be able to do? Well, an augmented reality experience developer is similar to a person who's doing web development or development of any mobile application. They have authoring tools, and they use those to design the relationship between the physical world, the trigger data, we call that, and the digital objects. It could be text, images, videos, animations, or 3D models. And they author a relationship, and together that is packaged and it can be published and delivered to the device, the smartphone or tablet or eyewear, and presented to the user when the real world stimuli comes around. We call these people who use the tools to create and author augmented reality experiences, we call them AR experience developers. And they use software development kits. Sometimes those kits and the services are hosted. They can use also app development environments and tools such as Unity 3D and many of the mobile tools such as Eclipse for Android and Xcode for iOS. So here there's not anything really revolutionary or unique. Then they often have to choose some more advanced tools or choose some of the workflows that are offered by tools that have been published. And I'm going to go through a few companies right now that provide those AR tools. One of those is called Metaio, M-E-T-A-I-O. And there are about 100 companies that are certified Metaio developers. This is just the first page of, I think, 30 pages of companies that you could contact to request a proposal to help you in a particular domain or perhaps in your geography, and they can help you to develop an AR experience. Matthias says that there's as many as 50,000 keys that have been issued for platforms in the past. Another company is called Layer, L-A-Y-A-R. They have 20 companies who are certified partners, and they have gone to a special level to be more advanced. And there are also tens of thousands of Layer partners and keys that have been issued. So many, many people have access to this tool. Another company is called Wikitude. There are over 40 companies that are premium Wikitude developers and over 400 that provide services commercially to third parties, and probably tens of thousands of other keys that have been provided. I can't give you just one or two companies that I would go to. I think it depends heavily on the vertical market or industry that you're in, the goals that you have, the geography where you live and work, and then you would choose the best partner for your project. Or you could also evaluate your own skills or the skills of some of your employees and determine if they might be able to make augmented reality experiences using the software that's out there today. An augmented reality experience developer probably has some design skills, instructional design, game design, graphic design, and usually it's very valuable to have some 3D skills as well, to have a good working vocabulary about three dimensions and how objects and are both in the physical world are expressed and how we describe the 3D models in the digital world. And together, graphics, design, and 3D with a human-computer interaction in background, a few classes or examples or some experience in human-computer interaction design is very valuable. So I already mentioned that having formal training is valuable, but that's not required. There are people who can put their hands on these tools and have a lot of imagination and can put that to good use. Experience with web and web-based services is very valuable. Augmented reality requires the management of some databases so that you can track where the assets are, what the permissions around those assets might be, and sometimes there is programming involved, sometimes a lot of programming involved. It's also very useful to have some business, marketing, and sales skills in order to know the value of what augmented reality is offering and be able to charge for that. If you're thinking that you want to get involved and get started with augmented reality, I recommend that you visit the tutorials and the webinars that are provided by these companies I already mentioned. They have a lot of developer support tools on their portals, and they also sometimes have occasional meetings of people who are augmented reality developers in different parts of the world. That might be a good place also to go and network with people who are already doing augmented reality development and can provide more guidance. Another company that's been very active in the area of augmented reality for mobile platforms is Qualcomm. They offer something called Vuforia. Vuforia is an SDK that allows you to extract the features very quickly from your targets and then extract those features and use them in another authoring environment. So this is a component. It's a modular component of an augmented reality end-to-end workflow that you need to be able to prepare the assets to be recognized. If you're thinking of yourself getting started with augmented reality today, I suggest that you try out some of the tools. Most of the tools are available for a trial, and then you would want to create an example project yourself using a couple of these tools, and you can compare them for your own preferences, the kinds of precision that you might need, the targets that you might need if you're working mostly indoor or outdoor, and then be able to choose the one that works best for you. if you really want to get very, very involved in augmented reality and you'd like to become a researcher or you'd like to start a company on this, you might want to also advance your studies at a university in Europe or the US or Asia. And here are a few of those where you might go and find out more. Well, let's say you're just not ready to become a developer quite yet, but you would like to have some experiences today, and I'm going to give you some information about what you might be looking for around you. Well, all around us in the physical world are points of interest, and in the language of augmented reality, we just call them POIs. They're usually stationary, so a lake, a mountain, a city, a statue or landmark. There can also be text. Text can be something you visualize as part of the augmented reality experience. It can also be the target of an augmented reality experience. So it gets recognized, like a position in the geospatial domain or an image. Images can be computer generated or hand generated, hand drawn, and they might be cylindrical or another simple 3D object. So the geospatial point of interest is the position of the user is calculated based on their GPS reading, and then the knowing where the point of interest is in the same coordinate reference system, we determine the difference or the position with respect to each other in this larger framework. This is very, very simple and easy to use for attractions like monuments, landmarks, museums. And it's often used for finding restaurants or retail businesses that want to attract their users by being a little bit more innovative. It might be a shopping center or a particular city will have a chamber of commerce might develop an augmented reality application to help people find the places, the businesses. Some cities have also developed augmented reality for providing public service, like where is the evacuation, case of emergency, where is the police station, even the restrooms might be part of an augmented reality application. So some examples of text around you are signs, business cards, or labels. Labels might appear on a product or just anywhere around us. And they could be recognized quite easily by the camera and using computer vision. Also using computer vision, we might be able to find an image that is already been detected and stored. For a good target, it needs to be rich in detail, have a lot of contrast, and you don't want things that are shiny. So you don't want a glossy finish, and you want to be able to quickly do the analysis, so you don't want a lot of repetitive patterns. So you should check the software that you choose to get the real details on the recommended image sizes and formats, because they do differ from one platform to another. Here's an example where the technology might have originally been developed for a fast-moving, for a cereal, for a food product, and yet it's also the same exact technology can be used in a workplace environment. So this is a person at Tesco who is using a tablet to scan the shelves and to detect if there are any products that are not that are out of place. They might not have, the retail front has a contract with the company that provides the product, and they want to make sure that they are fulfilling the requirements of that and they're in compliance. So this is an example of where the same technology is good for the consumer can also be used for productivity enhancement. We can have those boxes, although they had a very flat face and that's what was being detected on the shelf, we can also have 3D targets that can be round or cylindrical, as I mentioned with the can of Pepsi or the bottle of Pepsi. As long as there's some unique features on there can be detected, like a curved image. And they may also be an image target with multiple faces. As long as the geometry is consistent, then we can have a good AR experience. Very, very soft, or what we call deforming surfaces or targets, are not good because the augmented reality computer vision algorithms have to work much harder to detect a textile, the patterns on those kinds of deforming surfaces. So I'd like to recommend that you look around, because I bet you that there are some posters in your environment, brochures for a real estate company or for some other product, certainly on packaging in your stores. Magazines and newspapers have very, very likely some targets in them. The products that have rigid shapes and non-reflective surfaces work best, and we can also assume that in many of the built world, the urban environments, there are targets. Try it yourself by taking out your IKEA catalog and downloading the IKEA application. If you have children, you might also be aware of the Scholastic Book Fairs, which has an application that has augmented reality features. You might try some of these other sources. Yelp has an application for helping people find crowdsourced references for restaurants and other places of business. They have a feature called Monocle, which you can download, and it's an augmented reality view for helping you find places of business nearby. If you want to learn more about the constellations in the night sky, you might want to download Starwalk or Google Sky Map. Those are applications that you just point up at the sky in the night or in the day, and it will outline where there are constellations and other, planets and other features of the sky. If you are also still pointing up in the sky and you'd like to know what the route or destination of a plane is, you'll want to download Plane Finder. If you're on the road and you'd like to test out augmented reality navigation, I recommend that you take a look at Eye on Road. And if you happen to be looking for a Wi-Fi hotspot and you're in an unfamiliar area, maybe you'll want to download Lookator, which will help you to find your Wi-Fi hotspots that are open and available. So there are also many games. There are shooting games and also an AR basketball game. Dozens and dozens of games. If you're interested in a variety of applications from many different publishers, then I recommend that you try one of these mobile augmented reality browser applications, because just like a browser on the web, a mobile AR browser allows you to see content from many different publishers without having to download a new application each time. Let's turn for a few minutes now and talk about the state of the art in AR. So I wanted to just define what I mean by the state of the art. Augmented reality is something that's been in research for many years, and there's a lot of technology still in research and that are going to be coming out of those environments into pilots and proof of concepts. They'll be introduced, those technologies will be introduced commercially into future products. Augmented reality was available on a commercial product since about 2009. But it's not very widely adopted. So what does it mean to be state of the art? I think it means that, or according to some of the sources I looked at, it's the best possible technology at this time for producing AR experiences on mass market devices. So this is not on the lowest end devices. It's what's on sort of the mass market experience. I'm going to look at four areas. The first is recognition. You might have seen 2D barcodes. This is not quite the same thing as a 2D barcode. We call this an AR fiducial, and it has there can be any pattern, but it was something that was necessary a long time ago before the processors and the algorithms were ready to recognize more natural images. Those are no longer necessary. Today, everything has a unique visual footprint, and we've been able to piggyback or to take advantage of the fact that there's been a lot of research in computer vision for robotics, and that has advanced computer vision, which AR directly benefits from. The recognition can be done either on the device today, that has not always been possible, or in the cloud. The network is fast enough to transmit some of the features up into the database, as I mentioned at the very, very beginning, do a recognition there, and then transmit the objects or the assets down to the device. So there's a mixture of all those different scenarios out there today. The next thing that has to happen after I've recognized that there is an object, a target in the field of view of the user, is to track it or to keep track of it. As the user is changing positions or as the object is moving, we want to be able to keep the digital information on top of it. Those green boxes around the automobiles or around the people below are not what you see on the screen when you're using augmented reality. That's just what the algorithm outputs and keeps to itself to say, I know that that's a car and it's this size and in this position. We've benefited, just like computer vision has benefited from robotics, the science of automatically, you know, autonomous driving cars has also really helped augmented reality and accelerated the development of these algorithms. So tracking with computer vision is quite good, but it's not as good as your human eye, and it matters, the texture is very important. Another factor that will play into the accuracy of tracking is whether an environment is known or if it's never been recognized by the algorithm before. So if it's an automobile, that's got a shape that's quite recognizable, but there are some objects that have not been trained previously. I'd also like to mention that there are some algorithms that's called simultaneous location and mapping, different implementations on different devices and by different providers, and that's really what's common today in use. In the future, though, you'll be learning more about, or you could see perhaps mention of the parallel tracking and mapping, and that's called PTAM. So that's coming up, and I think that by the end of this year, we'll see a lot more PTAM. PTAM is important for 3D recognition, but that's not the only thing that you can use. I think we're going to see a lot more 3D in the future. Today already, you can do some elementary 3D capture using a still image camera or an infrared camera like you have on in the figure here. Google Project Tango uses IR. This is not mainstream and state-of-the-art today. We're still rendering quite simple 3D objects in the 3D world, and it's rare to see examples where the 3D model is really richly interacting or providing a lot of rich interaction to the user. So it's still very early days for 3D and AR. Now, how would you know there were AR experiences around you? This is also something that's been worked on quite a lot, and the state of the art today falls pretty much into these categories, plus the one on the next slide, and just I'll describe in a minute. Very common is a call to action that's printed, so it might be on a poster, a brochure, or a magazine, or newspaper, as you see here. So it's an invitation to download a particular piece of software. Or if you're already using the software, you can pivot or turn around and using the search function in the application, those different points of interest will appear. On the right-hand side of this picture is the results of an Irish property application using Layer. And so there you can see that there's information about the different properties for sale or for rent, and that they overlap or can cover each other. And that's showing that you know, we still have a lot of work to do to make it more intuitive for the user about where the information is attached to what. A lot of people, the platform providers that I surveyed said that social media is a very important vehicle for AR discovery, so you might keep an eye out on Facebook or Twitter because you'll probably see some AR experiences promoted there. So I'd like to summarize now and tell you a little bit more, sort of summarize what I spoke about today. Augmented reality is popular for brand engagement. It'll be used for many, many other applications as well in the future, but right now brands are the primary users and they interact with their customers to make them smile or to help them make purchasing decisions. I spoke about learning, and I think that there are many other use cases. This book gave you an example of one in the workplace, and there'll be more and more of those. Augmented reality experiences are prepared by developers, and there are, it's a multidisciplinary domain, so it's very challenging and I think an exciting area to be working. It's easy to find augmented reality in the environment around you, and there are many examples on YouTube. I spoke about the state of the art, but there still really is quite a lot of improvement needed to go, and we'll be talking about those improvements more and more in the coming episodes of this series. So with that, I'd like to pass this over to David, and we are ready for some questions if there have been, and I'd like to answer those.
Thank you, Christine. Yes, we did have a couple questions that came through from some of our participants today. So I will go right down the line in the order they were asked. This should take us right to the top of the hour. We'll start with number one. Participant asks, what are the biggest obstacles to mobile AR adoption today?
Well, there certainly are many obstacles. So I could spend a whole hour, maybe a whole day, talking about those. I think some of them are that people just haven't changed their behavior. They're not sure where there are augmented reality experiences. And when they're using augmented reality, even successfully, it can be very draining on their battery. It also looks weird. You know, holding up your smartphone or your tablet in front of you at eye level is a little bit awkward and tiring on your arms. That's probably one of the reasons that it's very popular for learning or print-based applications like magazines, newspapers, packaging, and so forth, is because the user is pointing the tablet or the smartphone down in kind of a natural position. There are many technology barriers that are not related to the user experience. Speed, being able to do the 3D that I mentioned several times. I think that for today, the obstacles really are the usability and then the just lack of awareness of where the targets are in around us.
Thank you, Christine. We'll move on here to question number two, which reads, why is geospatial augmented reality primarily for outdoor use cases?
That's a good question. Most geospatial AR is based on GPS, the global positioning system, and you have to be within sight of the satellites for that to work. So as people move indoors or when they use augmented reality indoors, and by the way, we spend 80% of our lives indoors, depending on, you know, the climate you live in and the region of the world. But so indoors, the GPS signal is weak or non-existent. So that's an obstacle. And we haven't really fully developed all of the indoor positioning technologies that are necessary to help us find those positions or those points of interest indoors. Indoor mapping is very, very popular, and it's happening in a big way these days, so I think that this is going to be a situation of change quickly.
Great. And our final question that came through, Christine, I'll let you answer this and then take us out. Participant asks, if more than one target is detected, can there be several active areas on the screen at one time?
Absolutely, David. Another great question. So imagine that you're pointing your tablet or your camera directly at a very complicated poster, and there's different zones that have been activated. It's absolutely possible, and those can all be enhanced at the same time. It's also possible that only one trigger, one particular target, can bring up multiple action buttons or multiple interaction points on the screen. So I might, for example, detect this question and the question mark on my screen using my augmented reality device, and it will bring up, do you want to ask this privately or publicly? Do you want to send it? Do you want to open? Do you want to start a phone call to inquire about this product or home that's for sale? So you can have multiple option or trigger little action areas, interaction areas on the screen at the same time. So it's very, very flexible, and there's a lot of design challenges ahead. Will be, I think this is going to be an area that will change rapidly in the coming years, and well, stay tuned. So that concludes our seminar, our webinar today. Thank you for your time and your participation. I want to remind you that there will be a Google Plus Hangout about augmented reality coming on April 17th at 11 a.m. Eastern Time. That's also hosted by the IEEE, and I want to thank the IEEE for their support. We'll be talking about augmented reality and wearable technology, how that is happening today, what's the rise, what are the different options available, and where is it going. If you want more information, please visit the IEEE Standards Association Google Plus page. And I look forward to hearing and seeing people in a future webinar. Have a great day, everyone. Thank you very much, David.
Thank you, Christine. Very great job, and I appreciate everyone's participation today. Have a good day.